Your fingerprint, your face, your voice, your DNA. These are all physical characteristics that are unique traits that make you, you. But here's the big question. Can the use of these biometrics actually violate your privacy? Multiple choice. Yes, definitely. No way. Or maybe. Well, the answer is probably more nuanced than you think. A better understanding of the technology will help answer the question. And maybe then, I won't actually need this tinfoil hat after all. For instance, on one hand, they make life easier. I'm always forgetting my passwords, but I never forget to bring my face with me everywhere I go. On the other hand, once your fingerprint or face is stored in a system, it may be there forever. Unlike a password, you can't just reset your face, at least not without some serious plastic surgery. So in this video, we'll break down, are your biometrics really secret? How do biometric systems work? How can they be used to improve security or misused to violate privacy? Can they be faked? And what happens if they're compromised? Let's go beyond the FUD, the fear, uncertainty, and doubt, and the conspiracy theories, and talk about how all this stuff really works. Okay, let's start with the definition. A biometric is a measurable physical or behavioral characteristic, like a fingerprint, an iris, face, voice, something along those lines, that can be used to uniquely identify or authenticate a person. Okay, but are they really a secret? Can you keep them from being collected? Would it even matter if you tried? We object to someone trying to fingerprint us, yet we leave our fingerprints on everything we touch. Same with DNA. We shed it literally everywhere we go. In fact, both my fingerprints and my DNA are on this cup, and in a few short minutes, it's going to end up in an unprotected trash bin somewhere. We even go out in public with our faces on the front of our heads for all to see. Yeah, I know it's a shocking idea, right? In other words, this is not a secret. And every time we speak, someone could be recording us. I'm not saying all this to make you paranoid. In fact, just the opposite. The point is, we essentially broadcast this kind of information about ourselves all the time and don't give it a second thought. And yet life goes on. So the issue isn't so much the biometric itself. It really comes down to consent and use. Okay, we've talked about now whether your biometrics are actually a secret or not. And again, they're not, because we expose them all the time everywhere we go. But now, let's talk about how they work. How does the technology actually work? Because there's a lot of myths and misconceptions about this aspect. So here's how it starts. We're going to look at two different use cases here. One is the registration use case, where we're going to register your biometric into a particular system. Let's again go with a fingerprint example. So we're going to capture your fingerprint on a device that knows how to read that. And what it's going to do is take that image. But that image is not what gets stored. So follow along here. We're going to extract that information, and the way we're going to do is map it onto the biometric. The fingerprint comes down here, and I'm going to map this looking for particular physical characteristics that are unique that might be something that make this something we'll recognize again. So if it's a fingerprint, we might be looking for what we call biometric minutiae, things like ridge endings, things like bifurcations, where a ridge starts to go in two different directions and things like that. And we're going to take all of that and we're going to note what is the X and Y coordinate of where that particular feature is in the overall picture, and also note the angle on the ridge. So we're going to take those things then and record a numerical representation. This is the thing we call a biometric template. The biometric template then has the XY coordinates along with the angle and the physical characteristic that we just noticed. And we're going to have a whole bunch of those. And then that is what gets stored in our database. Again, not your actual fingerprint or your face or your DNA. It'll be something along these lines, but a numerical representation of the things that stand out about it. So that's how we do the registration flow. Now, how about the way we use it? So let's go with the use flow. Now I come up to a system. I'm going to put my fingerprint on it in this example. We're going to take that image of the fingerprint. We're going to go through the very same process here again. We're going to map out the XY, look for the unique characteristics. We're going to map that into a biometric template, and then we're going to take that template and see if it matches what we have stored for this particular user. So we're matching and seeing, do these numbers match these numbers? And as I mentioned before, there has to be some room for error, because if we're looking for absolute precise matches, well, then there it could be that you were working in the garden one weekend and your ridges of your fingers are a little bit worn down, or if it's a voice biometric, maybe you've got a cold so it doesn't sound exactly like you, different things like that. So we have to introduce a little bit of error, an acceptable error, and decide how much that is. Well, that all comes down to how much risk you're willing to accept for this particular application. But that's how we basically make the system work. So that's how biometrics, the technology, actually works. Now let's look at how it can be used or potentially misused. So we'll take a look at different use cases that might be involved here. One is, it could be used for identification. In other words, in security terms, we use this terminology, identification and authentication. So it's the first part, it's the I part of the identification and authentication. So I'm picking you and your, and I'm trying to identify who you are based upon a biometric. Well, that's something that it depends on how it's being used. If it's part of an authentication case where I'm going to a system and I'm trying to prove who I am and the system recognizes me first and then I prove who I am, probably not a problem for us because I'm already going and trying to get into this particular thing to begin with. However, if that identification is being used in a different way, maybe to do tracking, maybe it's for mass surveillance or something like that, I think most of us would agree we're really not down for that. That's not something, profiling, tracking, that we really appreciate. But before you get too worked up about that, remember, most of you are carrying a tracking device with you anyway, and you're paying for the privilege. So your cell phone provider can tell where you are all the time. They have to be able to know that, or they don't know where to route your calls. So we're always being tracked one degree or another. Doesn't mean we just give up on the whole thing, but that's just trying to put some context around that. We're already having some of that happen. Now let's look over here on the other side. So I mentioned identification and authentication. So let's take a look at the authentication aspects and how biometrics could be used here. So authentication, I'll talk about some failure cases that can happen first. One is, and I've mentioned this before, is the false positive. So false positives are where the system believes it's you when it's not you. So I am you, in other words, in the system. How could that happen? Well, one way is using AI-generated deepfakes. So a deepfake is an impersonation, a video, your voice, something like that, that sounds and looks and acts like you, but it might fake out a system. Now, in general, biometric readers, especially like on a phone, are not going to take a video of you or a flat picture of you and accept that. So they will do a lot of other kinds of things, like sending infrared dots at you and looking to make sure that the image they're looking at is three-dimensional, not two-dimensional, maybe even looking for a heat signature, all kinds of things like that to make sure that it's not a deep fake. A lot harder to do that with voice. In fact, I'd recommend you not use voice as an authenticator. Use it as an identifier, fine, not as an authenticator because it's not reliable. Another thing you have to consider here are fake biometrics, where someone maybe does a situation where I lift your fingerprints off of a device that you've touched, something that you've touched, and then I make a mold and put a gummy version of that, almost like a gummy bear, that fits over my thumb that has your fingerprints on the outside because I pressed it into that mold that I created. And then now I can go to a biometric reader and get in. Now that's not as likely to happen anymore these days. The biometric readers are much better at looking and feeling for that capacitive kind of indication. But there are other examples where these things can be faked. Another thing to look at here are false negatives. So the false negatives are the cases where it's really you, but the system thinks it's not you. And that would be a situation that we're not going to be happy with. We're getting rejected out of the system. So that's just kind of a failure case. But ultimately, where these things can be very useful and not violate privacy is this use case. multi-factor authentication, where they're leaning in as an authenticator. And that, in that case, I've gone to the system and said, I want to get into the system, it's me, and now I'm trying to prove that it's me. So what do we have to consider with all of these? You can see it could be used, it could be misused. It all depends on that. Well, what are the factors that go into that? Well, as I mentioned earlier, consent is a big part of this. Did I give consent for my biometrics to be used? If I did, well, then it's not really violating my privacy. But if I didn't, maybe I feel very differently about that. How about this? Where is it being stored? The biometric information. Now remember, typically a biometric system doesn't store the actual image of your face, for example. It stores a numerical representation of that. But that's something to consider. Or your fingerprint. Where is that being stored? Well, one case, on your cell phone, maybe it's got a fingerprint reader, and the fingerprint reader is storing your fingerprint on the device itself. Not really a privacy issue then. However, if it's being stored up in a database, in the cloud, in the sky somewhere, then we don't really know who also might have access to this. So that could be a concern for us. And then there's also the issue of, well, everybody meant well at the beginning, but now we have function creep. The system starts being used to do things that we didn't intend for it to be used for, and now that's where the thing kind of gets out of control. So you can think of this stuff along a spectrum, where on one end, we've got a very valid use case of authentication, and like I said, that's something that we consented to. We have something else that we probably didn't consent to, some sort of profiling, and that we would probably object to, or it could be mass surveillance. And that, almost surely, most people will disagree with. All right, now we've just talked about how biometrics can be used and misused, and how they could be deepfaked or otherwise to cause confusion with the system. So the last question is, what if my biometric gets lost or compromised? Does that mean I have to get a new face? Well, let's certainly hope not. And in fact, you don't. There is research that continues to go on in the notion in the area of cancellable biometric information, where we take those numerical representations and use a SALT, which is a cryptographic technique, so that that way it's a unique representation that's unique to that particular system. So that if that system gets compromised, it doesn't compromise those same minutiae on all the other systems that are out there. So keep watching that space. Another thing we can do to protect, though, is never rely on a biometric as a single factor of authentication. It should be part of multi-factor authentication. So that way, even if my fingerprint does get compromised, well, I have more fingers, but even if that were the case, I'm still relying on more than just that alone. I'm relying on a password, something I know, or something I have, like a particular device. So with multi-factor authentication, we're reducing that risk surface by spreading out the different security mechanisms we're using. So I'm going to go back to our original question. Remember the multiple choice at the beginning? Do biometrics violate privacy? And I'm going to say the best answer is D. All of the above. In fact, in many cases, it actually protects our privacy by providing better security for our private information using strong authentication. But if used improperly, we end up with Big Brother from 1984. The bottom line is this: we leave biometric info everywhere we go, so trying to hide it is fighting a losing game. Better to focus, I think, on this, how the information is going to be used, and make sure it isn't abused. And if you do, well then, maybe we don't need the hat after all.